the recent Teachers' Congress, 3, in which the majority was influenced by the socialist revolutionaries, 4, adopted a resolution calling for a boycott of the Third Duma. The resolution was adopted with the direct participation of a prominent representative of the Socialist Revolutionary Party. The Social Democratic teachers and the representative of the RSDLP abstained from voting, as they considered that this question should be decided by a party congress or conference, and not by a non-party professional and political association. The question of boycotting the Third Duma thus arises as a current question of revolutionary tactics. Judging by the speech of its spokesman at the Congress, the Socialist Revolutionary Party had already decided that question, although we do not yet have any official decisions of the party or any literary documents from among its members. Among the Social Democrats, this question has been raised and is being debated. What arguments do the Socialist Revolutionaries use to support their decision? The resolution of the Teachers' Congress speaks, in effect, about the utter uselessness of the Third Duma, about the reactionary and counter-revolutionary nature of the government that effected the coup d'état of June 3, 5, about the new electoral law being weighted in favor of the landlords, etc., etc. 1. The case is presented in such a manner as if the ultra-reactionary nature of the Third Duma by itself makes such a method of struggle or such a slogan as the boycott necessary and legitimate. The impropriety of such an argument is absolutely clear to any social democrat, since there is no attempt here whatever to examine the historical conditions of the boycott's applicability. The social democrat who takes a Marxist stand draws his conclusions about the boycott not from the degree of reactionariness of one or another institution, but from the existence of those special conditions of struggle that, as the experience of the Russian Revolution has now shown, make it possible to apply the specific method known as boycott. If anyone were to start discussing the boycott without taking into consideration the 2 years' experience of our revolution, without studying that experience, we would have to say to him that he had forgotten a lot and learned nothing. In dealing with the question of boycott, we shall start with an attempt to analyze that experience. The most important experience of our revolution in making use of the boycott was, undoubtedly, the boycott of the Bulagan Duma. 6. What is more, that boycott was crowned with complete and immediate success. Therefore, our first task should be to examine the historical conditions under which the boycott of the Bulagan Duma took place. Two circumstances at once become apparent when examining this question. First, the boycott of the Bulagan Duma was a fight to prevent our revolution from going over, even temporarily, to the path of a monarchist constitution. Secondly, this boycott took place under conditions of a sweeping, universal, powerful, and rapid upswing of the revolution. Let us examine the first circumstance. All boycott is a struggle, not within the framework of a given institution, but against its emergence, or, to put it more broadly, against it becoming operative. Therefore, those who, like Plekhanov and many other Mensheviks, opposed the boycott on the general grounds that it was necessary for Marxists to make use of representative institutions, thereby only revealed absurd doctrinarism. To argue like that meant evading the real issue by repeating self-evident truths. Unquestionably, a Marxist should make use of representative institutions. Does that imply that a Marxist cannot, under certain conditions, stand for a struggle not within the framework of a given institution but against that institution being brought into existence? No, it does not, because this general argument applies only to those cases where there is no room for a struggle to prevent such an institution from coming into being. The boycott is a controversial question precisely because it is a question of whether there is room for a struggle to prevent the emergence of such institutions. By their arguments against the boycott, Plekhanov and company showed that they failed to understand what the question was about. Further, if all boycott is a struggle not within the framework of a given institution, but to prevent it from coming into existence, then the boycott of the Bulagan Duma, apart from everything else, was a struggle to prevent a whole system of institutions of a monarchist constitutional type from coming into existence. The year 1905 clearly showed the possibility of direct mass struggle in the shape of general strikes, the strike wave after the 9th of January, 7, and mutinies, Potemkin, 8. The direct revolutionary struggle of the masses was, therefore, a fact. No less a fact, on the other hand, was the law of August 6, which attempted to switch the movement from the revolutionary, in the most direct and narrow sense of the word, path to the path of a monarchist constitution. It was objectively inevitable that these paths should come into conflict with each other. There was to be, so to speak, a choice of paths for the immediate development of the revolution, a choice that was to be determined, of course, not by the will of one or another group, but by the relative strength of the revolutionary and counter-revolutionary classes. And the strength could only be gauged and tested in the struggle. The slogan of boycotting the Belagan Duma was, therefore, a slogan of the struggle for the path of direct revolutionary struggle and against the constitutional monarchist path. Even on the latter path, of course, a struggle was possible, and not only possible but inevitable. Even on the basis of a monarchist constitution, it was possible to continue the revolution and prepare for its new upswing. Even on the basis of a monarchist constitution, it was possible and obligatory for the social democrats to carry on the struggle. This truism, which Axelrod and Plekhanov tried so hard and irrelevantly to prove in 1905, remains true. But the issue raised by history was a different one. Axelrod and Plekhanov were arguing beside the point, or in other words, they sidestepped the issue which events put to the conflicting forces. By introducing a question taken from the latest edition of the German Social Democratic textbook, the impending struggle for the choice of a path of struggle was historically inevitable in the immediate future. The alternatives were these. Was the old authority to convene Russia's first representative institution and thereby for a time, perhaps a very brief, perhaps a fairly long time, switch the revolution to the monarchist constitutional path, or were the people by a direct assault to sweep away, at the worst, to shake, the old regime, prevent it from switching the revolution to the monarchist constitutional path and guarantee, also for a more or less lengthy period, the path of direct revolutionary struggle of the masses? That was the issue historically confronting the revolutionary classes of Russia in the autumn of 1905, which Axelrod and Plekhanov at the time failed to notice. The Social Democrats' advocacy of active boycott was itself a way of raising the issue, a way of consciously raising it by the party of the proletariat, a slogan of the struggle for the choice of a path of struggle. The advocates of active boycott, the Bolsheviks, correctly interpreted the question objectively posed by history. The October-December struggle of 1905 was really a struggle for the choice of a path of struggle. This struggle was waged with varying fortune. At first, the revolutionary people got the upper hand, wrested from the old regime a chance to immediately switch the revolution onto monarchist constitutional lines and set up representative institutions of a purely revolutionary type, Soviets of workers' deputies, etc., in place of the representative institutions of the police liberal type. The October-December period was one of maximum freedom, maximum independent activity of the masses, maximum breadth and momentum of the workers' movement on ground cleared of monarchist constitutional institutions, laws and snags by the assault of the people, on a ground of interim, when the old authority was already undermined, and the new revolutionary power of the people, the Soviets of workers, peasants, and soldiers' deputies, etc., was not yet strong enough to completely replace it. The December struggle decided the question in a different direction. The old regime won by repulsing the assault of the people and holding its positions. But, of course, at that time there were no grounds as yet for considering this a decisive victory. The December uprising of 1905 had its continuation in a number of sporadic and partial mutinies and strikes in the summer of 1906. The slogan of boycott of the Wittai Duma, 9, was a slogan of struggle for the concentration and generalization of these uprisings. Thus, the first conclusion to be drawn from an analysis of the experience of the Russian Revolution in boycotting the Bulagan Duma is that, in the objective guise of the boycott, history placed on the order of the day a struggle for the form of the immediate path of development, a struggle over whether the old authority or the new self-established people's power would be called upon to convene Russia's first representative assembly, a struggle for a directly revolutionary path or, for a time, for the path of a monarchist constitution. In this connection there arises a question, which has often cropped up in the literature, and which constantly crops up when this subject is discussed, namely, that of the simplicity, clarity, and directness of the boycott slogan, as well as the question of a straight or zigzag path of development. The direct overthrow or, at the worst, the weakening and undermining of the old regime, the direct establishment of new government agencies, by the people. All this, undoubtedly, is the most direct path, the most advantageous as far as the people are concerned, but one that requires the maximum force. Given an overwhelming preponderance of force, it is possible to win by a direct frontal attack. Lacking this, one may have to resort to roundabout ways, to marking time, to zigzags, retreats, etc., etc. Of course, the path of a monarchist constitution does not, by any means, exclude revolution, the elements of which are prepared and developed by this path as well in an indirect manner, but this path is a longer, more zigzag one. Running through all Menshevik literature, especially that of 1905, up to October, is the accusation that the Bolsheviks are bigoted and also exhortations to them on the need for taking into consideration the zigzag path of history. In this feature of Menshevik literature, we have another specimen of the kind of reasoning which tells us that horses eat oats and that the Volga flows into the Caspian Sea. Reasoning which befogs the essence of a disputable question by reiterating what is indisputable. That history usually follows a zigzag path and that a Marxist should be able to make allowance for the most complicated and fantastic zigzags of history is indisputable. But this reiteration of the indisputable has nothing to do with the question of what a Marxist should do when that same history confronts the contending forces with the choice of a straight or a zigzag path. To dismiss the matter at such moments, or at such periods, when this happens by arguing about the usual zigzag course of history is to take after the man in the muffler 10 and become absorbed in contemplation of the truth that horses eat oats. As it happens, revolutionary periods are mainly such periods in history when the clash of contending social forces, in a comparatively short space of time, decides the question of the country's choice of a direct or zigzag path of development for a comparatively very long time. The need for reckoning with the zigzag path does not in the least do away with the fact that Marxists should be able to explain to the masses during the decisive moments of their history that the direct path is preferable, should be able to help the masses in the struggle for the choice of the direct path, to advance slogans for that struggle, and so on. And only hopeless Philistines and the most obtuse pedants, after the decisive historical battles which determined the zigzag path instead of the direct one were over, could sneer at those who had fought to the end for the direct path. It would be like the sneers of German police-minded official historians such as Treitschke at the revolutionary slogans and the revolutionary directness of Marx in 1848. Marxism's attitude towards the zigzag path of history is essentially the same as its attitude towards compromise. Every zigzag turn in history is a compromise between the old, which is no longer strong enough to completely negate the new, and the new, which is not yet strong enough to completely overthrow the old. Marxism does not altogether reject compromises. Marxism considers it necessary to make use of them. But that does not in the least prevent Marxism, as a living and operating historical force, from fighting energetically against compromises. Not to understand this seeming contradiction is not to know the rudiments of Marxism. Engels once expressed the Marxist attitude to compromises very vividly, clearly, and concisely in an article on the Manifesto of the Blanquist Fugitives of the Commune, 1874, too, these Blanquists wrote in their manifesto that they accepted no compromises whatever. Engels ridiculed this manifesto. It was not, he said, a question of rejecting compromises to which circumstances condemn us, or to which circumstances compel us. I must beg the reader's pardon for being obliged to quote from memory, as I am unable to check with the original text. It was a question of clearly realizing the true revolutionary aims of the proletariat and of being able to pursue them through all and every circumstances, zigzags, and compromises. 11. Only from this angle can we appreciate the simplicity, directness, and clarity of the boycott as a slogan appealing to the masses. All these virtues of the slogan are good not in themselves, but only in so far as the conditions of struggle for the choice of a direct or zigzag path of development are present in the objective situation in which the slogan is used. During the period of the Bulag and Duma, this slogan was the correct and the only revolutionary slogan of the Workers' Party, not because it was the simplest, most forthright, and clearest, but because the historical conditions at the time set the Workers' Party the task of taking part in the struggle for a simple and direct revolutionary path against the zigzag path of the monarchist constitution. The question arises, by what criterion are we to judge whether those special historical conditions existed at the time? What is that distinctive feature in the objective state of affairs which made a simple, forthright, and clear slogan not a mere phrase but the only slogan that fitted the actual struggle? We shall take up this question now.